evening book club, don't know when yet, on Sundays.
Do we want to start next Sunday?
No, it's Labor Day. Bruce is playing.
Oh, Bruce is playing?
Yeah, he's playing.
Okay, so the following Sunday?
Yeah, it's, I mean, as long as that's moved with that, because she's always being correct. Or I'll be able to just argue with the state here.
I don't know how they say.
We can stay here and do it.
Mm-hmm.
come to affirm our covenant and sacred promise to be in loving relationship with you. Thank you for giving us life. Open us, body, mind, and spirit, to your truth. Fill us with your grace so that we can fall in love with your world and offer and experience forgiveness, reconciliation, and hope. Today's reading will be brought to us by Beth.
Impurity is not sin. To be impure was not wrong. How does that
that many of them were not offering condemnation or sin, but basically rescue human conditions. Part of our study of the ancient text should be an exploration that asks, is this a lesson for all time, for our time, or was it just for that time? The Pharisees also lived in a particular time, and their response to their condition was to adopt stricter adherence to the law than was common. In their zeal, they even added to the number of regulations, as if the more than 600 found in that book of Leviticus weren't enough. They weren't challenging enough to follow. Embracing this created ethic wasn't also sufficient for them. And as a result, the Pharisees used their power and position to impose their ethical commitment onto others. And their fixation on following the law and its enforcement, they missed the person to whom the law points. And this seems to be their fundamental struggle with Jesus. See, he keeps trying to show them God's self, while they consistently question him about why he doesn't do what they want, expect, or require. See, the Pharisees want God in a box, neat and lovely. I think you can imagine how I feel about that. I'm not a God in a box person. You see, the Pharisees completely resist a God who surprises with extraordinary grace, uncommon compassion, and liberating freedom. They don't understand that God did not intend to prescribe a set of rules in the first place. They reject the God who does not reject the ones they demean, deride, denounce. Jesus presents the Holy One of love, and they want God as a sovereign of law and order. Perhaps that's why, when they gathered around, their attention was arrested not by his teaching, his healing, or mere presence. No. Those religious leaders noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing. See, of course, their version of washing hands was more complicated than the recommendations we received due to the coronavirus. They are talking about ritual actions to render the actor clean or pure. But these and those actions, as a part of the law, were largely associated with life and leadership in the temple. Again, James Gunn writes, holiness and purity are closely related, and breach of the holiness code is sin. And religious observance in a state of impurity is. It could only be that impurity was regarded as undesirable, to be avoided as much as possible, to be removed at the earliest opportunity. Being unclean was a condition that needed to be addressed, not a judgment on the worth and commitment of the person. The circumstances in which we find ourselves do not define who we are. They provide a condition that invites a response. Who really knows if the disciples were eating with dirty hands or not? That wasn't the Pharisees' concern, actually. Like some of us may think, you know, you hear that phrase, cleanliness is close to godliness, right? How many times did I hear that? Particularly from my mother-in-law, who was meticulous about keeping things clean, right? Well, that wasn't what the Pharisees' concern was, actually. Even if that was the initial point of the law, they sought so desperately to impose that they missed the opportunity to commune with Jesus. It's worth noting that only the Pharisees and other religious leaders seemed to attract Jesus' ire. Those so-called sinners, the diseased and disabled, the old and the young, the rich and the poor, all people of all genders, Jesus exhibited compassion and extended love and grace. Many of the encounters record Jesus interacting with people who fell short of God's intention and promise. But only those hypocrites actively worked against Jesus' promises and purposes. supplied a framework for maintaining right relationship with God, with one another, and with themselves. When Jesus summarized all the law as loving God and your neighbor as yourself, why would the Pharisees think the list needed to be expanded while letting love diminish, when love is the entire point? The Pharisees wrapped themselves up in an identity of their own creation. How many do that now in our own time? At the time of Jesus and Paul, hearing rules were fundamental identity markers. They functioned as part of a wider politics of purity, actually. Different concerns over purity would have led different groups to different perceptions of Israel's social boundaries, not only from an external point of view, for example, regarding the separation of Israel from other nations that we hear of in Leviticus, but also from an internal one regarding the separation of a specific group from the rest of the people, the different grades of membership within a group, the rivalry between the groups, and all of that. Consider the importance of identity as a religious group for the Pharisees, where particular religious practices are integral to a group's identity. Even minor gestures can become make or break points of division, and more weight should surely be given to the Pharisees. Their name generally agreed to signify separate ones. And thus indicating a wider perception of the Pharisees as a group defined themselves by their concern to keep themselves apart. A primarily purity concern. A purity concern does not equate with a concern for gods of gods. And surely there are those that God sets apart in terms of giving them a particular assignment to fulfill. The prophets present one example of this. Does it not provide for elevation or distance from the people in garments or gold within the people? That again is rooted in God's abundant love for creation. Jesus responds to the critique directly by taking their narrow concern and expanding it metaphorically to address their fundamental problem. The Exodus people had created an idol in the golden calf. The Pharisees had made an idol of their interpretation of the law as prophecy of Isaiah, warning, I quote, This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. It has been entirely too easy for God's people to create idols to worship. For some, our faith communities, it may be forms of worship that become idols. It may be the buildings in which we gather. Or it may be images and expressions of patriotism. None of these things in and of themselves are idolatries. It's our response and an over allegiance to them over God. It's not what we take in, Jesus said. It's what we put out. We have the choice of response. We cannot always control our condition, but we determine our reaction to it. Jesus calls on us to respond from the heart, with love. We honor God when the words from our lips and the meditation from our hearts manifest the actions in our lives. Our hearts are near to God when they are filled with love for God's creation, including and especially our neighbor. Our worship is fruitful when we enter into loving, graceful, and hopeful communion with the living God and not make worship an idol as we fixate on the place, on time, and style. We walk right when we're more connected with God's will than our own human divine doctrines. Most of this passage reflects a conversation that Jesus had with religious leaders and authorities, but his final definitive words were for the crowd. And I would say they apply to us all. We have noted before that Jesus regularly avoided the crowd, but here he calls them back. It's not enough that he sets the Pharisees straight and corrects their wrong teaching among them. Jesus doesn't finish until he sets the people free from the bonds put in place by those asserting a human authority and will over them. I imagine their Wisconsin friend that is going through treatment and testing for cancer. But it's all done in our prayers. And one other thought, I spent the afternoon yesterday with friends celebrating the life of celebrating the life of a young man that I knew since he was born. He died by suicide a few months back. I think I had shared that with you all and asked that you hold them in prayer. But I want to continue to lift them up in prayer because this is going to be a lifetime thing that they wrestle with and try to heal from. But I want to also give word and grace to God because there was much healing and great joy in time spent together yesterday. Tony would have been 28 years old and it was the 28th, so it was his golden birthday yesterday. And there were profound stories shared and tears shed and laughter heard. And you see the bracelet that I have on my wrist today is WWTD, which stands for What Would Tony Do? And Tony was also a spirit on us, fix our hearts and minds on what is true and
Thank you.